to do. Hark the voice God is calling to the harvest, calling you. Little is much when God is in it. Labor not for wealth or fame. There's a crown and you can win it if you'll go in Jesus' name. When the conflict here is ended and our race on earth is run, He will say, as we are faithful, welcome home, my child, well done. When we enter heaven's portals and our Savior's face we see, cares of life will be forgotten, we'll be happy, glad and free. Little is much when God is in it. Labor not for wealth or fame. There's a crown and you can win it if you'll go in Jesus' name. Little is much when God is in it. Labor not for wealth or fame. There's a crown and you can win it if you'll go in Jesus' name.
If you'll notice, all of our songs around missions. We need to have a heart for missions. We need to realize that people need the Lord.
Every day they pass me by, I can see it in their eyes. Empty people filled with care, headed who knows where. They go through private pain, living fear to fear. Laughter hides their silent cries. Only Jesus hears. People need the Lord.
Hear the word.
He's the open door. People need the Lord. People need the Lord. When will we realize people need the Lord?
From Luke's Gospel, chapter 16, we're going to begin reading in verse 19. This is one of the most sobering portions of Scripture that you'll ever come across. This is a story that reminds all of us of the urgency and the need to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ. Brother Rodney, would you read, please, verse 19, and we'll finish up in verse 23. Would you stand, please?
There was a certain rich man which was clothed in purple and fine linen, and fared sumptuously every day. And there was a certain beggar named Lazarus, which was laid at his gate full of sores. And desiring to be fed with the crumbs which fell from the rich man's table, moreover the dogs came and licked his sores. And it came to pass that the beggar died, and was carried by angels into Abraham's bosom. The rich man also died, and was buried. And in hell he lift up his eyes, being in torments, and seeth Abraham afar off, and Lazarus in his bosom.
Let's pray. Father, now we need your Holy Spirit conviction in this service. We need your work in every heart. I will be absolutely powerless to change anyone in this room. You do that. I acknowledge I'm just a mouthpiece. I'm just wanting to be used by you today to speak your word and preach your word. And we ask you to bless now your word, and may it lodge in people's hearts that, Lord, would come under the awesome awareness of their great need for salvation. We ask you to bless now in Jesus' name. Everyone said, amen. You may be seated. I take those three words in verse 23 that so moved me when I looked at them again. And in hell. I have never looked at this passage of Scripture without realizing that I am rehearsing an actual story. These are the words written in red. They're the words of Jesus Christ. I think we can be confident in saying that this is exactly the truth that we need to hear for our generation and for right now, anyone in this room. If there's an uncertainty in your heart, I pray that today uncertainty would be replaced with confidence, because you need that. I wouldn't want one single person under the sound of our voice today to leave this building without knowing where you'd be if you died. And so my first question is this: how does a person end up in hell? How? How can it happen? How would it be possible for a person that is born on this earth, live, and then end up in hell? I had the privilege yesterday going to Grady Memorial Hospital and helping a 94-year-old man respond in prayer for salvation. A wise and prudent man or woman on this earth will take God's offer for salvation. Now, I'm looking in the faces of every person in this room, young and old, from the youngest to the oldest. I don't know if anybody in here is 94 years of age, but the gospel works for any age. The gospel works for everyone. In fact, it's my distinct privilege today to stand before you and preach the only way to heaven is through Jesus Christ. That's it. I'd never stand here and apologize or try to. I have the best answer for your life, and His name is Jesus Christ. Hands down, you're at the right place today. But residing in your conscience, you wake up just like everybody else. You go through the motions of the day. You have thoughts. You function. You have movement and being on this earth. But in the back of your mind, you also have that conscious thought, I'm not ready. If I died right now, I don't know where I'd be. And you know, most common sense thinking people, most folks I've ever met, never plan on ending up in a place called hell. And everyone, I want you to understand, can't avoid that awful place. Hell is a reality. Just like the pew you're sitting in and the place you're at and the home you live in and the car you drive and the city you reside in and I could just go on and on. It's a reality. But here's the reality of Scripture where Jesus said. And so he begins this story of a certain man. This man just happened to be rich. He had all of this earth's goods and he had everything he didn't want for anything. And so he begins this story. He says, there was a certain rich man clothed in purple and fine linen and fared sumptuously every day. He had the best that this world could offer a man. He had food. In fact, when you read that in the verse 19 where it says he fared sumptuously, he lived in luxury. This guy had it. As far as the world concerned, everybody that looked at this guy, he was the GQ man of his day. He had arrived. He's got it. And then there was this fellow Jesus introduces to in verse 20. There was a certain beggar named Lazarus, which was laid at his gate, the rich man's gate, full of sores. Quite a contrast, isn't there? You got the rich man clothed in purple and fine linen, the best of clothing, had the best of food, had luxury, but then you've got the contrast that is even in this world we live in today of abject poverty. This man named Lazarus was a beggar. And he wasn't in the best of health conditions either. He had sores. In fact, the Bible says he was full of sores. I suppose it was a putrefying sight if you were to walk by this man. Well, verse 21, Jesus said, desiring to be fed with the crumbs. Which fell from the rich man's table. You know, to sustain life, maybe he just going to eat the leftovers of this rich man. That's all he desired, just what. And I would imagine what was left over and the crumbs and those kinds of things were probably sufficient to feed it. Fellow like this beggar. And a almost sickening statement, look at it. Moreover, the dogs came and licked his sores. Well, folks, it's a terrible, terrible thing to think that this beggar lived in these conditions on earth. I don't think in such a short amount of words you could make a contrast look so drastic as what Jesus gave to us. And really, Jesus is just giving us facts. That's all these are. But when we come to the next verse, this is what's happening right now to you and I and everybody on the planet. And it came to pass. You know what's happening to everybody in the room? I could say it like this. It's just coming to pass. We've got another day, don't we? It's another Sunday. It's almost like it's passing by, is it? I mean, time is just, the clock's ticking, isn't it? And this is so real for everybody. And it came to pass. Time went by and the rich man was faring sumptuously and had his clothes and had his luxury. And the And every day you woke up, well, the beggar was out there and he had these open sores and there's the dogs coming by. And this is just something that happened and it was just, listen, it's just time. It's just time passing by. And I want us to think about that just for just this moment, that time's passing by. It's passing by for you. It's passing by for me. Clock's ticking, and so here it is. But what happens? I'm looking into the faces. No matter how young or old you are, I'm looking into the faces of people that are. You're dying. It's just a matter of time, isn't it? It's just a matter of time before this happens. I'm not I'm here today and you're here today, but the time is passing, isn't it? So I wanted to make that point. I wanted to impress upon you the fact that we are really about the same situation. And then notice this. It happens. It happens. The beggar dies. But now wait a minute. Wait. It's not over, is it? Death is not the end. It's not the end, folks. Look at this. And was carried by who? Whose words are these? Is this what happened? The angels carried the beggar on earth. By the way, he's no longer a beggar, is he? He was carried by the angels into where? Now this is interesting because you got to get it theologically right. You got to understand this. Into Abraham's bosom. That sounds like, what do you mean, preacher? Well, he went to a place called, at this time, pre-Calvary, pre-resurrection. Old Testament saints, anyone who died having faith in Messiah to come, guess where they went when they died? To a compartment, a place, a holding place. You know what it was called? Paradise. Hey, I like the term paradise, by the way. That's okay. Waiting till when? Waiting till Jesus would rise. Guess what? Jesus went to paradise. 3 days, had a 3-day revival meeting, and then took paradise to now where all saints will abide to the third heaven where God dwells. A place called, listen to this, heaven. That's post-resurrection. But now Jesus is giving us, while he's on earth, the information about Old Testament, those who died pre-resurrection, all right? Pre-Calvary, all right. So here we have, he was carried by the angels carried him. By the way, all saints are carried by angels. But then there's this, Jesus is still telling this story. The rich man also died. Now it just says he was buried. But is it over for him? Go to the next verse. And there's where we come to that powerful, thought that everybody has to deal with. Everybody has to put this in the old computer, and you have to think about this. And Jesus, whose words? Jesus. And in hell. Wait a minute, it's not over, is it? It's not over. So those who die on this earth, go either to heaven or hell. And that's the only two places. Three things I want you to know about today's message about hell. Number one, I want to talk about the masses in hell. The masses. How many people are in hell? How many people are in hell? I asked the question originally, how does a person end up in hell? How did this guy that's found in this text breathe his last breath on this earth and his next scene was hell? Proverbs 27:20 says, hell and destruction are never full. Isaiah 5:14 says, therefore hell hath enlarged herself and opened her mouth without measure. Hell had to be enlarged. Did you know how to answer the question, how does a person end up in hell? I'm gonna answer it right now. You have to. It's almost. How does a person end up in hell? You don't have to do anything. Nothing. If you do nothing, you'll end up in hell. You have to do something. And you know what that something is? Receive and believe in the one and only provision for your soul. You have to pray on purpose to receive Jesus Christ as your Savior. So how does a person end up in hell? This man, he let time go by, the clicks of the clock, every bit of the time went by in his life. He drew his last breath and he did nothing about his soul. When all the while, listen, the beggar laid at his gate and the beggar had it. The rich man didn't go to hell because he was rich, and the beggar didn't go to heaven or to paradise because he was poor. That's not how this works. Do you want me to tell you how it works? Rich or poor, free or bond, all have to come to the foot of the cross. All have to believe in Jesus. I don't care who you are in this room. We're in equal standing before God. We need His Son, Jesus Christ, as our Savior. The masses. How do people end up in hell? And we already know that hell has enlarged herself. We already know that out of the world we live in right now, can you take a little inventory with me? Can we take a little guesstimate of who's ready and who's not? So we already know there's these people on the earth that are deceived by religion. Did you know religion is a big business? It's very deceiving. And there's a lot of people that bought into deception. And I'm just here today with one book, with one way, and you either take it or you leave it. You either receive it or reject it. It is your choice, by the way, where you want to spend eternity. But the fact of the matter is, I can only tell you this book comes to the conclusion of one way to heaven. One. There's not 2, 3, 4, 5, 10 different ways to heaven. There's God's way, and His way is through His Son that He sent to this earth, dispatched to this earth to die for the debt of all of Adam's race, their sin. There's only one provision for your soul. And there's only one provision for the debt of your sin. It's Jesus Christ. So I want you to know the offer is still standing today. You don't have to reject it. You don't have to end up in a place called hell. Now, this kind of preaching is not real, real popular in our day. But it's real, real needed. Because a lot of folks just do not know the way, the truth, and the life. If I were a mom or dad, I would want my kids to hear a preacher preach about hell. I'd want my children to hear the truth. You say, well, this could scare them. I want you to know, I was 11 years of age when I got saved. You know what the overwhelming reason is because I got saved? I did not want to go to hell. When I was growing up, preachers preached hell hot and often. Revival meeting with W.W. Baker, Ms. York, you remember? That September revival we had in 1967. I was an 11-year-old boy, and I was invitation on Friday night, and my knuckles were white, holding on to the back of the pew. But I'll never forget telling my mom, I just took out from the pew I was in with them and walked forward, and fellow right back there, George Davis, met me in an altar of prayer and opened the Bible and showed me John 3:16. Do you believe? Will you pray to be saved? Yes. My answer was to the affirmative. Yeah, at 11 years of age, even an 11-year-old boy can take God's offer for salvation. Anyone, anywhere, anytime, any place in a service like this, you can be saved from that awful place. There's a lot of folks going in. So if you take all the masses of humanity, 7 billion people on the planet, did you know there's 1.25 billion and growing in Muslim religion? And the Muslim religion is false to its core. It is a lie. And if you follow the Muslim faith and draw your last breath, you will not end up in a place called heaven. Are you listening? You will not. You must believe in Jesus Christ. You must believe in Jesus Christ. We had the privilege in Africa of seeing some Muslims come to faith in Jesus Christ. It really happened and continues to happen. People need Jesus. And then you take all the other religions of the world and you add them all up, and all of the Buddhists and all of the Hindus and all of the, and you just go on down the isms, and I'm telling you, the devil has manufactured many, many false religions, but there's one true salvation. And if you agree with that, say amen. Amen. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. I am so blessed to know who Jesus is. Did you know if you are saved, you will not experience one macro second of hell, not one. You'll never experience the wrath of God. It's amazing. I'll take God's offer for salvation. I hope everybody else will. You talk about the masses in hell, and then you can't pass this up. Memories in hell. Memories. People have memories. A person in hell will remember their life that they had on earth. Luke 16:22 says this. And it came to pass that the beggar died and was carried by the angels to Abraham's bosom. And the rich man also died and was buried. And in hell, verse 23, he lift up his eyes, being in torment, seeth Abraham afar off, and Lazarus in his bosom. He knew who Lazarus was. He remembered. And he cried and said, what did he say? Father Abraham, have mercy on me. He knew who Abraham was, and he had never met him. And he said, send Lazarus that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am tormented in this flame. But Abraham said, son, remember that thou in thy lifetime receivest thy good things, likewise Lazarus evil things, but now he is comforted and thou art tormented. Do you remember? Is there a memory for those that are in hell? Do they remember? You bet. And listen to this. It's forever. It's forever. Did you know there's a burden of those in hell? Those that are there, they don't want anybody else to come there. Can you imagine this man? He had some brothers. He had some brothers. He said in verse 27, then he said, I pray thee therefore, Father, that thou wouldest send him, speaking of Lazarus, to my father's house, for I have five brethren, that he may testify unto them, lest they also come into this place of torment. Did you know? That rich man became a missionary. He had a concern for souls, his own brothers, and he desired that they would not come to that place of torment. When we have the testimony of a man in hell, and by the way, he's there right now. That man that's in hell, the rich man, he's still there, and he'll be there for eternity. And so what we have is a reality. Hell and those in it have a memory. And they have a burden, and they don't want anybody else to come. And then the third thing is the miseries, and I don't have to elaborate on that too long. Torment. Fire. I've only been around two or three people in my lifetime that have. There's some people in this room. You've had experience of having a severe burn, third degree. It's so unpleasant. It's horrible. Now we're talking about a situation where there will never be an escape from flame and fire. And it's a place of torment. And so, folks, I've got to ask you, why would you want to go there? Who in their right mind would want to even gamble with their soul? Let's bow our heads. I really hope and pray that I want you to set aside all your emotions and feelings, and I want you to take the time And I'm gonna make this. The Lord already gave me this instruction before the service. I want to lead you right where you're sitting. You don't even have, listen, you don't even have to get up. I can't make it any more comfortable than this. But just like that 94-year-old man yesterday was willing to pray in his hospital bed, laying down, he prayed from his heart. And you can do that very same thing right now. You're sitting there today and you're not sure. You're just not sure that if you died, you'd be in a place called heaven. In fact, you're so uncertain of it that you're willing to pray today on purpose for God's salvation to come into your heart. And so right where you're at, if you feel and sense that need, a wise and prudent person will say yes to God's offer. And so I want you to just imagine it's just you and me. And I'm there and it's just you and me and the Lord. And I would take any person in this room and I'd do this very same thing. I would lead you in this prayer for salvation, but you have to pray this prayer from your heart to the Lord. You have to pray this prayer. And you know how you pray? I want to lead you in it right now. You pray it like this. Dear Jesus, I know I'm a sinner. I know I've sinned and I'm very sorry. Please come into my heart and save me. Thank you for dying on the cross for my sins and giving me your gift of eternal life. I want to be in heaven with you forever. Thank you for saving me today. With our heads bowed, no one looking around but myself and the Lord. If you prayed on purpose for the very first time in your life for this salvation, and you meant with every fiber of your heart, you meant this prayer, would you just lift up your hand? Just lift up your hand so I can see your hand. I prayed, yes, I see that hand. Is there anyone else? Is there anyone else? I pray. Anyone else? I know it takes a little courage. Do it. Let's stand to our feet. Let's stand to our feet. And if you prayed to receive Jesus, I want you to come forward and I want you to meet me at an altar of prayer right here. And I'm going to rejoice with you and I'm going to be thankful that you prayed today to be saved. Why don't you just come right now? Make that public. Don't be ashamed of Jesus. He saved you. Just come on down. We'll rejoice with you. Brother Sean, would you sing?
Just as I am with
I just received Jesus in my heart. I'm standing up here.
But that
anyone
thy
at all?
Blood was shed
anyone
for
at all?
Me.
I saw one hand. Would you come?
And that thou be me come to thee, O Lamb of God, I come.
I know we've talked about folks being saved today. Maybe you're here and you just need an altar prayer. Maybe you just need to pray. Maybe the Lord has spoken to your heart. You need to join this church by letter, by statement, or by baptism. Will you come on? As God leads you today,
just
whatever the Lord leads you to do,
I am and waiting not to rid my soul of one dark blot to thee, whose blood can cleanse each spot.
I'm so thankful for your coming today. Got Caden Baker comes today. Caden accepted Jesus Christ as his Savior in my office. Caden, do you know you're saved? Yes, he said. Those willing to receive him into membership through baptism, uplift your right hand, good hearty amen.
Amen.
We're going to get ready for baptism. All right. Yeah, give him a hand. Come on up, Mom, Dad.
So here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. King of all days, oh so highly exalted, glorious in heaven above. Humbly you came to the earth you created, all full of sin became.
Amen. There we go. I knew it was in there somewhere. Let's all stand. Thank you for coming today. Please don't forget that we have community groups tonight. We also have those who would like to be part of finger food back in the back at 5:30 and with service at 6. And don't forget, 6:30 every night this week, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, there's going to be no snow. It's not going to happen. All right? Don't take my word on that. All right? But just make sure you're here for that. Also, sign up for the International Banquet. We have a great time with that. That's at 5 o'clock on Saturday. We thank you so much for coming today. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we love you so much. We thank you for this who has followed you in believer's baptism. Lord, we pray that we would reach out to others. We would think about missions in our heart, Father, as we have these great men and their families coming in this week. Lord, we ask that each one of our members would be in their places, Lord, and that you would break our hearts for the lost. In Jesus' name we do pray. Amen. Ladies, women of faith meeting, that's what it is. Women of faith meeting.